The Darwinian notion of survival of the fittest is wrong. Rather, nature merely allows for the survival of the sufficient. Instead of natural selection, one could say natural editing. And along these lines, there is no final edition, but merely reprints, new versions, remainders, dustbin copies, and discards. If you remain, you have been edited to some degree. Ah, this is also a good metaphor for our own lives. We are constantly being edited by so many different editors, moment to moment. Parents, friends, teachers, priests, rabbis, lovers, exes, food, environment, you name it, it is editing you. I am merely a temporary editor who is assigned the job of making certain that my writers, also known as sperm, produce enough copy to make tomorrow's edition count. And by the way, deceiving oneself and others is how the job gets done. Deception is nature's method of making sure that each individual in each varying species has enough wiggle room to successfully compete in a landscape insufficient to keep everyone alive and happy. In other words, nature uses deception to edit.
The laws of probability and chance indicate that if an infinite number of monkeys are given typewriters and allowed to peck away for an infinite time, they will eventually produce all the world's great literature. But in the process, we find monkeys, like humans, also turn out quite a bit of absolute junk.
My friend, man did not evolve from the ape, but the ape evolved from man.
Notice you come into my genome. I'm glad you're here. I was just wondering how my DNA was going to be transmitted. The creationists realize now that talking about God or the Bible just doesn't work when it comes to science, so they have dressed up the old man in sheep's clothing and Trojan horse the intelligent design idea under the pretense that there is just way too much complexity at the level of the cell to be arranged by chance forces. Mike Behe's infamous book, Darwin's Black Box, and Philip Johnson's Darwin on Trial are the two major texts guiding the new creationism. The problem is that both books have been heavily criticized by molecular and evolutionary biologists as being wrong on the facts, wrong on the science, and wrong on methodologies. My personal hunch is that the intelligent design movement is just another attempt for Christianity to shoehorn God back into biology because evolution is such a devastating critique of Genesis. Fundamentalism is a mental disease. To which I would add, creationism is taught only by those who cannot think. Daniel Dennett, in Darwin's Dangerous Idea, rightly said that natural selection is probably the single greatest idea to permeate human thought. Once you understand evolution, then life and its confusions become clear and decipherable. Indeed, it is the awesome simplicity of the idea that completely devastates you. Dennett calls it the universal acid. Once you hold it, it burns through everything, every concept, every ideology, every ism. Is there an intelligent design to the universe? No. And that is why nature's cruelty, ironically, becomes intelligible. As Darwin was fond of quoting, "Nature is red in tooth and claw," and to think otherwise, that there is some compassionate God behind it all, only tortures us unnecessarily. Evolution liberates human beings from the folly of a designer God with intelligence. Chaos in the beginning, order in the middle, chaos in the end. As Robert De Niro rightly commented when asked if there was a God in heaven, well, he has a lot of explaining to do. With evolution, God doesn't have to explain anything because he has been exempted from the equation. In other words, there is no God, and thus he is no longer viable as an explanatory alternative. What makes Darwinian evolution successful is not its articles of faith or belief, but because it allows for so many testable avenues of investigation, which lead to all sorts of surprising and unpredictable consequences. It also leads, lest anyone forget, to pragmatic results which include antibiotics, GMOs, and a deeper understanding of why viruses and bacteria still thrive, even when we have the medicine to counteract them. Our brains didn't evolve to understand the universe, but to literally eat it, as in survive the local ecosystem long enough to transmit one's genetic code. We have invariably conflated our appetite with truth. We don't know the truth. We simply know what it takes for us to live skillfully enough so that we don't get eaten too young. And if we live long enough, the redundancies, or spandrels, or secondary effects, of our enlarged cerebral cortex allows us the freedom to ponder imponderables and impute upon those mysteries all sorts of silly nonsense, with the added caveat that such idiocy will last provided it floats our boat to live another day. Let me rephrase that. Nonsense evolved as an adaptive function of an enlarged brain because believing nonsense makes more sense, in terms of replicating strategies, than coming to grips with the random chaos from which the universe apparently arises. Tom Blake might put it this way: nature is without sentiment, but those who feel sentiments have a better chance of surviving this horror show than those who do not. Why? Because any meaning is better than no meaning, even if the universe ultimately is devoid of purpose. As Voltaire would say, in my twisted way of paraphrasing him, man would have to invent God even if such a being didn't exist. We cannot live without purpose, even if that purpose is an adaptive fiction evolved over eons of time, designed to blind those with such sentiments from the truth that nature has no such sentiment. Too much truth and you cannot move. Too much reality and you become autistic. Which is another way of saying that Jack Nicholson was right all along. We cannot handle the truth. But the truth surely has a good way of handling us. It lies to us in order for us to live an extra day. Think about it. The truth is that truth lies.